this was the first fully televised American foreign policy crisis ever.
And with each passing day, the temperature was rising.
There's a lot of propaganda from the other side against us and trying to picture us as militants, as violent reactionaries.
حتی مخالفمون باید گفتمان کنیم.
I couldn't pass up the chance to be part of history, frankly.
We might be the group to get the hostages released.
If the politicians can't do it, maybe people, just interacting with people, could help.
We were greeted by mostly women carrying AK-47s, and, well, this is different.
We come to you, our beloved brothers and sisters, in a sense of solidarity.
In that moment in Tehran, I was very afraid.
Lord, what am I doing here?
I'm thinking, am I going to be the 53rd hostage?
دولت ایران بله میخواست که آقای خمینی میخواست که ایشون رو امریکایی‌ها به ایران تحویل بدن. گفتن خب بیان ایران محاکمه میشود.
A phone call from the operations center at the State Department, and they said that the embassy had been overrun. The students who took over the embassy gradually broke into one part of the embassy after another and took our people hostage.
The pictures were of several of the hostages blindfolded being led out of the U.S. embassy.
We were transfixed. That's when they started covering the hostage crisis every night, day one, day two.
This is day 76. This is day 77 of the hostage crisis.
People felt so attacked and embarrassed by this little bunch of Iranian students who could take our people hostage. They didn't like it at all.
آقای خمینی این رو انقلاب دوم خوند و چون اول به وزیر کشور گفته بودن که نه بزنید بیرون کنید بعد گفته بودن که پسر ایشون تلفن کرد و نه اینا خودی هم کاری به کارشون نداشته باشید بعد هم روز دوم بیانیه ایشون صادر شد که انقلاب دوم
میدونستن راه حل قضیه این هست که شاه رو از امریکا اخراج بکنن ولی من تعجب میکنم چرا اصرار کردن به این که دائما شاه رو نگهش دارن
ما او رو میخواهیم نسبت به عمل کرده 50 ساله گذشته یا 35 ساله دوره حکومتش محاکمه کنیم
Negotiation was a taboo at that time. It meant compromise and giving in to the will of a superpower.
شبکه‌های امریکایی کاملا سانسور میکردن حرفای ما رو یا بیانیه‌های ما رو چون بالاخره مواضع ما ضد دولت امریکا بود.
Gradually we realized that much of the message why we have taken this action was not getting through. So the students started making contacts with other Iranian students in the United States.
I received a call very early in the morning. They said that they are calling on behalf of the students of followers of Imam. I was asked to gather 50 Americans to come over to Iran as their guests. I thought this is a prank. You really could not believe this.
ایده این فکر این بود که ما باید با رقیبمون، حریفمون، حتی مخالفمون باید گفتمان کنیم. و اون کسی که تبلیغ می شود و به ناحق ما رو وارون جلوه می دهند، ما اون روی واقعی خودمون رو نشون بدیم.
In the morning, I called my dear friend Norman Forer. Norman Forer was very sympathetic to the Iranian students during the revolution, quite active in most of the progressive movements in the campus. So I said, could you believe that I received a call? Isn't this crazy? He said, as crazy as it sounds, my friend, this could be a magnificent opportunity. Maybe we can go and convince them to take a different measure and hopefully help the release of the hostages. I pointed out that this is not gonna go anywhere. Everybody's going to say, forget it.
I got a call from somebody that I knew who said, would you be willing to go on a trip to Iran to try to free the hostages? I said, yeah, sure, I'll go.
He was trying to draw people with a civil rights background. There were some people with a theological background. I think he was looking for people who represented a broad spectrum and who were at least willing to go on this delegation to see what we could accomplish.
It was an opportunity for an adventure beyond anything I'd ever dreamed of. I have to admit that I had visions in my head that we might be the group that might help to get the hostages released.
I had never been outside of the United States before in my life, and we would be spending 10 days with the students, many of whom were actually ones who had seized the embassy and were holding the hostages. I couldn't pass up the chance to be part of history, frankly. I thought this was a pretty historical event.
If the politicians can't do it, maybe people, just interacting with people, could help. My son, who was 15 at the time, said, don't go, Mom. They just want another hostage.
I remember my former wife saying, you got to get $1 million insurance policy in case you don't come back alive. And I asked people in the insurance business if they would cover me, and they said no.
For the first time in my life, draw up a will before I left, and spent a considerable time persuading my friends and relatives, particularly my parents, that I wasn't crazy.
We have to take into account the possible downsides that we would be associated with the radicals or people who were regarded as un-American or something like that.
I think all of us did see risks in going. Unless there was a resolution found, we were afraid that things would unravel and there would be some catastrophic conflict.
And I didn't even let my parents know that I'm going back to Iran because I wasn't too sure what will be the outcome of this. And I did not want to make anybody worry about me and what I am doing.
I was pretty clear that we were walking onto a global stage as a handful of individuals, which is a pretty rare circumstance. I also was aware of the fact that we were not going at the behest of the United States government or the approval of the United States government.
And so these people, with good intentions, going off to Iran, there's no question in my mind that we would have opposed this and thought that it was a waste of time and potentially dangerous.
I thought, personally, that who knows, these guys may have a chance. They may pull something off that the rest of us can't see.
All the members of the delegation assembled at Riverside Church and on the Upper West Side of Manhattan. And I guess we were taken to Kennedy Airport and we took off for Tehran.
We were about to arrive in a country that has been designated by our own government as a hostile entity, and it became very real.
I guess I hoped that we would kind of lay the ground, all of us together, for more hopeful negotiations to release those hostages.
We were walking on very, very thin line of disaster and magnificent outcomes.
I do remember when we landed at Mehabad Airport. Here was an airport like a terminal at JFK, totally denuded and stripped of all the signs and just pictures of the revolution in Khomeini.
We were greeted by mostly women wearing long black chadors and carrying AK-47s. And I remember, well, this is different.
They were really upset. And none of us could figure out why. They collected our passports.
I was not expecting to have my passport seized. It never even occurred to me that such a thing could happen.
I guess it really came up to me, this is really serious. Who knows what's going to happen?
The airport was emptied out and there were no other passengers there. It was just us. We had no idea what was going on or why we were being held there.
Norman was going back and forth, of course, trying to figure out what is going on. That created a lot of anxiety among the group.
It did cross my mind that if they were loggerheads, Professor Fora and the militants, maybe the whole trip would be doomed.
There was a sense that we would be put on a plane and sent home.
There were a lot of issues in the foreign ministry where some of the people there didn't like the idea of inviting the 50 American guests. Some of them just didn't understand what the concept behind the whole event was.
بعد از اینکه رسیدن اونجا حالا ببینیم که ویزا ندارن. از طریق این آقای خمینی به شورای انقلاب فشار وارد شده که شورای انقلاب موافقت کنه که اینا ویزا داده بشه. وقتی که این قضیه انجام شد من گفتم ببین که شما دانشجویان که بس میگفتید ما دولت در دولت نیستیم و در کار دولت دخالت نمی کنیم.
And eventually, after many hours of negotiations, we were finally given permission.
We were taken to our hotel, which had been renamed the Hotel of the Glorious Revolution.
I believe we were the only residents at the time.
But I remember going into the hotel room and throwing myself on the bed because I was so exhausted. And then immediately comes the call for dinner.
The dinner was ready and we had arranged everything. A lot of them were quite surprised at meeting the students face to face. And some of us that he had probably seen before through the interviews.
I had a lot of different impressions of the students. First, you know, how young they were. I mean, these were, you know, 19, 20, 21-year-old kids. Secondly, how well organized they were. They seemed to have a committee to take care of just about everything.
در حقیقت ما پرستار 24 ساعته اینها بودیم. هم نگهبانشون بودیم. هم غذا بهشون میدادیم. هم پذیرایی میکردیم. هم گفتمان باشون داشتیم.
I was kind of dismayed when I first saw that each of them had a rifle on their shoulder.
I got a little tense because I am not used to being surrounded by people and with guns.
And one of the women who did have her chador and her rifle, and she said, oh, it's because of the revolution. It's just part of our assemble, part of our outfit.
Yeah, I have a sort of jokey style anyway, so I remember thinking, wow, I could die in somebody's revolution, not because they were shooting me, but because they dropped their gun. And then lo and behold, somebody did drop it. That was a little unnerving. It didn't look like a terribly safe environment.
We started talking with them, spending more time with some of them.
As far as I can tell, within their student movement, the women had an equal voice and were in positions of authority.
I came to that delegation with all of the, you know, sort of classical American biases about Muslims in general and Muslim women in particular. And so to see these women as prominent people, leaders, was a surprise.
They didn't know exactly what they have ahead of them, what they should expect to see.
What would we do? Would we spend the entire time in a hotel talking to students? Would we be able to travel around the country? No one really knew at that point.
We had an opportunity to convey the message of the Iranian people to the world.
ما فکر می‌کردیم خیلی راحت ما حالا چند تا آمریکایی رو می‌ریم داخل ایران، به اینها میگیم که چه وضعیتی داخل ایران وجود داشته زمان شاه و بعد آمریکا چه بلایی سر ما آورده.
At first, I was sort of shocked. Why are we going to a cemetery? What's this got to do with anything? We're here to talk about the hostage crisis.
We had a visit to Behesht-e Zahra, the cemetery where lie thousands of martyrs of the revolution.
It maximized the emotional impact, and it brought the tragedy of what really took place into the focus of the delegates.
It was real. These were lives. These were parents, children. These were losses.
And I thought, how intimate this is to bring us to the place of death, their loved ones. And having a picture of the person who was buried there, dominantly on display, and you think, Lord, what am I doing here?
It became clear to me that for them, for the families we met, this was life and death. It was not just politics.
There is no speech or interview or discussion more effective than actual experiencing what the Iranians are experiencing on a daily basis.
It was an emotional experience in a lot of ways to see just fields of people who had been buried there and allegedly had been killed by the Shah. I have no doubt they probably were.
And these people were not armed people. They were ordinary people just protesting, just speaking out, just protesting to the Shah.
At the same time, what those students immediately were telling us, that the United States was also a partner to crime.
The American president had supported the Shah, although they probably knew that the people were being killed in their cold blood in the streets of Tehran and other cities.
We come to you, our beloved brothers and sisters, in a sense of solidarity.
When Professor Fora spoke at the cemetery very eloquently, I kind of remember that.
They are the martyrs for those who have suffered.
He was almost like a rabbi, you know, giving a eulogy.
Because they have been driven from their villages, have seen their families divided and destroyed in the slums of the cities.
And it's this tremendous empathy that he expressed.
Long live the Iranian Revolution.
Allahu Akbar!
I think that was a smart move by the students, gathering the group first time in Iran at the cemetery, was to have the maximum impact on the first sort of moment.
We visited a hospital. There were lots of young men there who had been wounded in the course of the revolution, and possibly also some who had been tortured. The red tulips are a symbol to Iranians of both of martyrdom and also of rebirth. So it's one of the primary symbols of the revolution.
I remember distinctly praying for the health and well-being of a patient, raising my hands over him and invoking the priestly blessing from the Book of Numbers.
May God watch over you and protect you.
Inshallah, Khuda az shoma hifazat bokone va mawazib shoma bashe.
You know, when a rabbi asks a blessing, we don't think of politics. We don't think of agenda. We just think that's a sick person.
And that we hope and pray that there never again will have to be another February 11th for the Iranian people.
I came away from the visits to the hospital with a deep sense of sadness and the seriousness of what our government had helped their government do to them. That was hard. The prison was one of the notorious places that political prisoners were kept under the Shah's regime. The prison itself is massive and forbidding, grim place.
The basement area was like a morgue within the prison, and we looked at all these photos and we were told that each photo represented a demonstrator who was killed.
That was very difficult. It's difficult today. And seeing pictures of all those people up there who had been martyred, it was very emotional and angering at the same time.
I didn't want to look at those pictures. And I wanted to turn away from the horror of it all. But then I recognized that I had made a commitment to be part of this delegation. And so it was part of my responsibility not to avert my eyes.
This certainly was compelling documentation of the evil that had happened during the final years of Shah's rule.
We met some of the former prisoners and some of the former guards.
That blew me away. Give me a bit. It blew me away and it angered me all at once. You know, we had a guy there speaking who admitted to being one of the people who was the main torturer in Savak. He also detailed where some of those torturers were trained, and they were trained at US bases. And he would detail how he would torture. He was rather cocky and arrogant.
It was extraordinarily emotional. I was very, very agitated.
Our delegation had become very hostile to those guards over the things that they had done, to the point that I remember the students saying to us that we needed to calm down.
I don't remember much until the point where I was faced with the man whose work I knew as the Minister of Health.
از جمله موردی که اتفاق افتاد این که در ملاقات زندان با آقای شیخ الاسلام وزیر بهداری زمان شاه به عنوان وزیر بهداری زمان شاه راجع به شکنجه های ساواک صحبت کرد که من به عنوان وزیر هیئت دولت شاه میگویم که چه اتفاق افتاد.
I remember quoting him in my doctoral thesis, and he was to be killed within the next couple of days. This is somebody I could have known in New York, someone I could have interviewed, someone that I would have had great respect for. They weren't presenting us with evil people necessarily. They were bringing together individuals who made the decision in favor of the Shah and what had always been the government were going to be killed, and the others who knew to go to another side were not. I remember thinking, this is extraordinarily painful to me. Because I felt like I could have been there. And that was really tough.
The delegates, of course, original agenda was to focus on the hostages. But the cemetery and a few other experiences basically put that in a back burner for a short period.
Either before or around meals, there would be hostage takers who would come and talk with us about various things.
I felt responsibility to show that we're not the ugly Americans, that we're decent human beings, we care about you, the Iranian people.
But I had to explain why I thought what they were doing was wrong, to explain how Americans could not accept or understand the taking of hostages.
مهمترین مسئله براشون این بود که بالاخره اتباعشون اسیر دست ما هستن و اینو هیچ ملتی به این راحتی نمیپذیره.
We did hope that we would be able to meet with the hostages or maybe even in our wildest hopes that they would release hostages to us.
Norm felt was a possibility that the hostages could be released, but that it would be more comfortable to release them to representatives of the American people than to release them to the American government.
Even the students had this idea that you would equip the group with a few of the hostages, if not all, to allow them to express what they experienced in Iran.
برای اونا ثابت شد ما اون روحیه‌ای که میگویند کینه‌توزند، وحشی‌اند، خشنند، بی‌رحمند باید با مخالف گفتمان کرد که بگوییم اونچه که در تصور توست ما نیستیم. باید اونچه که ما هستیم خوب تشخیص داده بشه که چی هستیم و چگونه فکر میکنیم.
From the beginning, the students had said to us, at some point you'll be allowed to just roam free. And there were times for a few hours where we just walked the streets of Tehran.
The streets in the part of Tehran where we were beautiful. They were, you know, beautiful classic buildings. It was a cosmopolitan place.
My impression of the people was that they were lovely people, frankly. Very much like us. Maybe hospitality more thoroughly ingrained in them.
So everywhere we went, people were very friendly. I'm not sure how they knew we were Americans. I'm sure some student group went ahead of us and let them know we're bringing some Americans in. People didn't see us as the enemy.
I remember being very intense in Iran. Like, we're here to meet the Iranian people and see the condition of this country. But all the while, we prayed that we'd be able to see the hostages.
Mel and Rick and I took a walk. We wanted to go down to the embassy itself. And I wanted to see who the people were who were standing outside like that. In those days, I still smoked.
Luann lit up a cigarette. She stood there on the street corner in Tehran with a cigarette, and traffic stopped.
My scarf was sliding off my head. But I wasn't conscious of that because I was smoking and I was talking to the guys. And
men just stopped in their cars and got out and started yelling at her.
I knew this was serious.
It was clear that people were unhappy with her. She was violating customs.
I felt scared. I'm not usually scared. In that moment in Tehran, I was very afraid.
An important issue was to give them a proper image of what had happened during the Shah's regime to this country, and to understand that the people who actually were suffering due to the severe poverty, the economic challenges that the country had at that time.
I remember the slums. I remember looking into the faces of the poor mothers and their children in the huts. That left a big impression.
It was cold while we were there. I had on a heavy wool coat. And here were these people living in these makeshift huts with walls of cardboard. And it was shocking.
I had never seen this. I never saw the garbage and the sewage and the people right next to each other. And it was very crowded also. It was very dense.
And they supported themselves by scavenging through the garbage dump. That was a big occupation for children, was seeing what they could find in the dump that they could sell for a little bit of money to buy a little bit of food.
I didn't think any revolution was going to solve this.
I want to review for you the activities that we have engaged in since we've been here. I will summarize the most important of them and then give you a general picture of some of the other things that have gone on.
What I remember was always being conscious of how important it was to get a meeting with the hostages.
We were making the request every day, and it was always, yes, we'll get to that. Yes, we'll let you know about that later.
They just wanted to tell the glorious story of the revolution, and the lure of seeing the hostages might not come true. I was like 50-50. I thought, the chances of us seeing the hostages.
The hostages were caught in the middle of a political crisis, both internally and externally.
بعدم رفتم به سفارت با دانشجویان صحبت کردم. بعدم که من به ریاست جمهوری انتخاب شدم، اینا تا اون وقت در عملاً یک دولت در دولت تشکیل داده بودن. گفتم اختیار دست سپاه پاسداران بود، دانشجو تو کار نبود، دانشجو پوششی بود.
Somebody in the government made some sort of comment about how if the government needed to use force to take the hostages away from the students, they would.
یعنی اون زمان اینجور صحبت بود. قوای ارتش اینا جانشین بشوند برای حفظ امنیت سفارت و اعضاش و چیزا دانشجویان اونجا رو تخلیه کنند. بعد آقای اینا به آقای خمینی مراجعه کردن و او رو قانع کردن بگه نه این کار نشود. و وقتی اون که گفته نشود رئیس جمهور چاره چی داره باید بگه تکذیب کنه دیگه.
That's when I think we really began to realize that no matter how well-meaning the students had been, that they were not the ones that were making the final decision as to what would happen to those hostages.
We had a lot of time together with the guests discussing exactly what was going on in Iran and trying to explain the convictions behind the Islamic Revolution, the fervor of the revolution, the aspirations of the people. I think that a lot of this was the core message.
It was the anniversary of the revolution and we were told there was going to be a mass rally. We thought, well, this will be pretty cool. We'll go and see this.
Inviting the delegation for the celebration was quite spontaneous, even by the students.
یعنی تا الان ملت ایران تجربه نکرده که سالگرد انقلاب یعنی چی، چی کار باید بکنن. هر کسی برای خودش برنامه‌ای داشت.
We boarded our buses and we got to see a little bit of the city just by driving through from our hotel and going to the outskirts where this huge field where the rally was taking place was.
I've never seen this many people in one place in my life. The bus had to push its way through the crowd. And it's raining outside. It's raining rather hard.
It's one thing to see those demonstrations on TV, but when you're there, that was just amazing. The voices booming out.
I didn't know what was being said, but you had the enthusiasm of it. You know, you knew that they were celebrating this event. And I was really glad to be there.
Yelling, Mahbad, America, you know, death to America. But then smiling at us and saying, we don't mean you, we mean your leaders.
The political atmosphere was quite charged and nobody was in full control. And in the middle of that, you had 50 Americans. Anything could happen.
I got off with my group from my bus, and I noticed that the field was very muddy. It had rained a lot.
They had set up this rickety scaffolding for us to view the parade in front of Freedom Square.
We were ushered up to the top, along with a lot of other people who were guests, I think, from other Islamic countries, perhaps from liberation movements around the world.
All of a sudden, they felt that the scaffolding is giving way.
In Darbast, شروع میکنه به
this swaying started to happen.
I realized this whole thing was about to collapse.
The guy next to me said, I want you to hold on to me, and we're going to jump.
Jump off maybe 10 or 15 feet.
and land pretty hard on the ground.
It went down backwards.
It collapsed like an accordion.
And suddenly we were thrust down.
I just remember the ground coming up.
It was a total chaos.
همینها هول کرده بودن که الان این اتفاق که بیفته دست و پا میشکنه.
It was an enormous structure. Someone could have easily been crushed and killed.
I ended up underneath, and it was dark. It was very muddy, and it was hard to breathe, and there were bodies everywhere. And I didn't know if everybody was alive. I thought I might die in that.
The people in our immediate area panicked because they thought it was an act of sabotage.
I remember looking around and saying, how are we ever going to get out of this crowd? We're going to get swallowed up. It was really scary.
And so people began to run in every which direction. I think I have a broken ankle, and I'm being knocked this way and knocked that way by people running by me.
And then the students actually went under the scaffold.
Somebody pulled me out and picked me up, and they carried me.
People mobilized very quickly, formed human chains to get us back to our buses.
And then they drove some while. I thought, Lord, I wasn't killed back there, but I'm about to be killed here.
They take me to a hospital. Eventually, I'm seen by an Iranian doctor who speaks perfect English. Has me sent to the x-ray room, and the x-rays don't work. And he tries again, and they don't work. And he tries again, and they don't work. And I said, what's the problem? He said, we have so little money spent on medical equipment. Even the film that we're using is out of date, so I'm not getting a clear picture here. So after about four or five x-rays, finally he gets one that he can read. And he says, fine, you don't have a broken bone here, but I'm going to put your leg into a cast, and it's soft tissue damage. You should be able to get back home easily with this.
و اگر اینها زیر دست و پا که دومشون لطمه‌ای بهشون وارد می اومد، اون صحبت آقای کارتر درست در بود که امنیت چشمشون کورشه، امنیتشون با خودشون. ما که گفتیم ایران مردم وحشی داره چه.
I think that scene, though, and the collapse of the bleachers at the moment when millions of people were gathering to celebrate the first anniversary of the revolution, for me, it became symbolic of what happened with that revolution. It was tragic. We traveled through a desolate desert landscape to what people called the holy city of Qom.
Where the famous teachers of Islam taught.
We did visit one of the big mosque there, which is just really amazing to behold.
I remember being startled by the architecture, by the plazas, by the filigree and the tile work.
It's a very ornate place with lots of light sort of bursting off of the walls with all these little mirrors in it.
Really felt like we were moving into something out of another world.
And there we met Khamenei, I think his name is pronounced. As I remember, he talked about the U.S. government and how we needed to change it.
Norm would make his presentation to not hold back about what was unacceptable and wrong and destructive about the hostage holding on the one hand, and on the other hand, profoundly compassionate acknowledgement of the suffering of the Iranian people.
In this whole process, I became acquainted with Ahmad Khomeini, Ayatollah Khomeini's son, who became a friend of me.
We also met with, I believe it was Ayatollah Montazeri. I think we sat on cushions on the floor and were served tea.
And had these little trays of goodies passed around to us.
I was afraid that maybe it would all just be a visit with
their views and their beliefs and attacking the United States and all of that with no effect on the hostage situation at all.
I think members of our delegation had made some entreatment to him to see if he might intervene on our behalf. As I recall, he listened patiently to our request, but made no indication what he would or wouldn't do.
At that point, my notion of bringing hostages home was significantly tempered.
I felt frustrated and disappointed that we couldn't reach out in kindness and support to the hostages, and I really was praying that we would be able to see the hostages, but I had increasing doubts that this might happen.
We knew that there had not been an agreement to release an American hostage. We understood that. And we had not met with any of the hostages. And so we felt that until and unless we at least had a meeting, that this had become a one-way street. We were meeting our obligations and assumptions of what this was about, but the Iranians were not meeting theirs.
The students knocked on the door about 5:30 in the morning, and they said to Jack Bremer, my roommate,
"Jack, could you come with me?" I said, "Of course I will."
Took us down the stairs into a darkened van. We went careening around the streets of Iran for quite a while. Then all of a sudden, here we are in front of the embassy. Then I said, "Jack, we're going to see the hostages today."
Guys, oh goodness. 11 of us were going to visit the hostages, the people with the most clear religious connections. I had to sort of calm myself because I wanted to jump up and down. I walked into that former U.S. embassy is now was a clandestine or a place for the Americans hostages. And I thought, if there is anything I can do, I will do it. How do I do my part to help to bring closer to fruition a genuinely positive result from this mess?
Then the hostages came in, Paul Lewis and Bill Gallegos. I was disappointed that only two hostages came out to see us, and I thought it was like a token, like they really didn't want us to talk to the hostages. They looked nervous, and we realized how did they know who we were exactly? I remember breaking the ice with them and saying, "Hey guys, I guess you want to know who won the World Series, and you must have missed McDonald's," and they sort of relaxed because we were talking American to them.
It was a pretty joyful time. I mean, the Americans being held hostage were really happy to see us. I was concerned about the condition and the treatment of the hostages.
The way I recall, they said they were treated okay, but I was very, very doubtful. It was a very dark time for them. They had already been there 4 months.
We certainly hoped that they were finding ways to make life in that situation bearable. And I understood that is going to be a very brief visit for them. And so I was taking notes as carefully as I could so I could pass them on immediately if I could to say, "Your son is okay," or whatever.
As we were finished speaking with Paul Lewis and Bill Gallegos, and the hostages had been permitted to write letters to their loved ones back home.
And we made clear to them how much of a wonderful opportunity this was for us to do something for them, for the hostages, and for their families. So I shook hands, as did each member of the delegation, because the conversation now was going to be over. I was trying to keep it together, not break down. And I stuck my hands in my coat pocket.
And then what happened, you know, was as we were leaving, the student said, "We have to detain you. One of you has received a secret message from one of the hostages." And they were staring straight at me. And I remember thinking, wow.
I said, none of us would be that foolish.
So they took us out one at a time.
They ushered me into a courtyard quite a distance away and said, we're gonna search you, take off everything, and I did, right down to my skivvies, yeah.
So I'm standing there in my underwear, and I realized maybe he thought that when I put my hands in my pocket.
And it was a long few minutes that they searched me, and I'm thinking, am I gonna be the 53rd hostage? I said, oh my God, the family that I love, will I see them? What will happen?
I wanted them to be certain, not only that I didn't take anything, but that neither of those two hostages gave me or anybody else anything that they hadn't told them they could. I absolutely didn't want to be the cause, even accidentally, of any additional burden on those hostages. They searched all the pockets and found nothing.
And finally, after the longest 10 or 15 minutes of my life, they let me go. And as they were letting me go, I tipped up my head covering, my yarmulke, it's called, my kippah. And I said, you forgot to look under here, boys. I kind of felt, oh, good, I said that.
I was deeply moved by the honor of being in that room with those hostages. I mean, it felt like the whole trip was now worth it. Just being able to go there, get a sense of their safety.
They assured us that they were being treated well, that they were having good food and much daily exercise. They mentioned in many ways different kinds of recreation and experiences that were being supportive to them. All of them, of course, want to go home, very much so. But they assured us that the students are caring for their needs in a very helpful way.
And I think for the Americans' holiday, too, I think they were glad to have some sign from home that people are still remembering them. And that worked out all right.
The highlight of the last day in Tehran was getting our passports back, which I think happened as we were boarding the plane. We were a little worried about that, but it happened.
I do think that we felt like, okay, we've done what we can possibly do here. We're gonna just head home now and see what happens to us when we hit Kennedy.
I felt our mission had failed. We had made the best effort possible, and it was worth doing, but there were no hostages that were going to be coming home with us.
But to be able to bring back, I think it was 200 pieces of mail. It wasn't the freedom of the hostages, but I felt like it made the whole thing worthwhile.
We were met by a rather tumultuous crowd and an incredible amount of media just shoving microphones and cameras in your faces and wanting to talk to you, etc.
It was a bit of a mob scene, and Norm spoke. He described what we had learned and the need for a peaceful solution to the problem. He was met with mostly pretty hostile questions.
That they thought I was un-American. It hurt my feelings, because I am an American and I'm proud to be.
I was disappointed that we did not get national coverage for our trip.
The anger over the much more dramatic storyline and images of Americans being held hostage totally swamped any interest.
As far as mainstream media went, we didn't exist.
Had the hostages been released, it would have had a completely different impact. And the future of the two countries would have a different path.
That's what we told the students. Unless you can find a way to settle it in a way that opens the door to reconciliation, you have poisoned our future. And as it turned out, that's what happened.
During the
height of the crisis. We were proceeding with these indirect negotiations.
At the end of March, Bani Sadr takes his negotiating position and presents it to Khomeini, and Khomeini says no. So the game is over.
آقای خمینی نمیخواست از دست بده. برای سیاست داخلی میخواست کاملا مسلط بشه بر اوضاع. و بنابراین اونها راه نمیدن. چرا اینکه نکرد.
People in the Pentagon had put together a plan for a very complicated and extremely risky rescue mission.
4 a.m. I was awakened by Hal Saunders. He said, Henry, you know that thing that we were afraid was going to happen? Yes. Well, it happened, and it failed.
Carter announced it on television.
To my deep regret, two of our American aircraft collided on the ground. Eight of the crewmen were killed, and several other Americans were hurt in the accident.
It was, you know, obviously one of the most painful things that any president had ever had to do.
بعد اینکه کماندو بفرسته برای آزاد کردن گروگان ها و بعد گروگان بردارن ببرن و این پر خطر بود.
We were afraid that the failure of the rescue mission would lead the Iranians to take violent action against the hostages.
Anybody who had direct access to the hostage takers was somebody that the government was interested in, because we had practically none.
President Carter said to me, Jack, I think we just lost some of our boys. I said, no, sir, I don't think so. Somehow I gained a fairly strong rapport with these Iranian students. I'm not sure how I had the guts to try to do this, but I said, this is Jack Bremer. And they said, oh, Jack, we're so glad to hear you. I said, this is the message I send to you. Give me your promise before God that you will see that every young American is kept safe. They said, before God, we give you our promise, Reverend Bremer. We avoided the chaos of a U.S. crash. And then more bloodshed, retaliation following that.
I remember being so grateful for their release, and of course was very relieved.
Oh, I'm so glad. Yeah.
They kept their word. They told me they would keep their word, and they did.
Grateful that it finally happened, disappointed that it had taken so long. It should have ended much earlier.
The mother of William J. Dougherty, who was a Marine hostage, gave me a silver bracelet to wear for her son. So there we were in the White House, the Marine Band was playing. President Reagan, the families, and I was speaking with Bill Dougherty and his mother, and I said, Bill, you know what? I'm wearing the silver bracelet for you. Why don't you come to my temple in Newburgh? We'll have a big ceremony. I'll return the bracelet to you. And he said, Rabbi, if you don't mind, I'd like to take it now. And later he wrote me a beautiful letter, and he says, Rabbi, thank you for the bracelet. When you took it from your wrist and put it on mine, the pain began to go away.
I think what that trip to Iran in 1980 confirmed my belief in the connectedness of human beings.
I think if more people had a chance to actually go to Iran, to meet people in Iran, I think if our governments could get out of the way, our peoples could be friends.
I feel more than anything embarrassed that I arrived in Tehran knowing so little about what I was doing and left there
knowing more about myself and what I needed to do for the rest of my life.
It broadened my understanding that we are all in this together, that it's our world to make a better one or a worse one, and that we have to figure out a way to do that.
After this experience in Iran, I'm not the naive rabbi anymore. I realize we live in a very difficult and cynical world. And if somebody doesn't agree with you, you demonize them. And unfortunately, that's what Americans and Iranians did, and that shouldn't be done.
The reason that the United States and Iran today have such a terrible relationship is to a very considerable degree traceable back to the hostage crisis.
The events of the 1979 takeover of the American embassy are still very relevant events for contemporary history. They still overshadow a lot of the developments that are happening in today's world.
It's a catastrophic outcome that has continued now for 40 years.
The difficulties that we face at the moment are as much a product of Washington policy and decisions as they are of decisions in Tehran.
I know that we have fundamental differences with Iran, but we have fundamental differences with China and with Russia and with, you know, half the countries in the Middle East. But that doesn't mean that we don't deal with them in some way to try to mitigate those problems.
If I had known that 40 years later, 40 damn years, that the countries are still like this. That's an embarrassment. That's a shame.
So now we're slouching toward yet another kind of confrontation with Iran.
یه حادثه می‌بینی که سبب شد که جنگ ناخواسته انجام بگیره. پس باید همه کار کرد که نشود.
I wish that after our delegation, I wish we had been followed by dozens of delegations.
If I get a call tonight, I'm being asked to gather 50 Americans to fly over and visit the country, I wouldn't hesitate a second.
I'd do it at the drop of a hat, in a heartbeat.
You bet I would do it again. And besides, the people-to-people stuff is worthwhile.
Where do I sign up?
Would I go? Of course I would. I think any peace-loving person would say, I'm willing to do that.
I'd certainly like to meet with the young generation. I think I could relate to them. I really do. Maybe bridge a little bit of a gulf.
Hopefully, a delegation and a dialogue could pick up where we left off 40 years ago. And lessen the tensions, at least to some degree, that our two nations are facing today.
So, yes, if I get the call and I would be asked, I would not hesitate a second. Of course, this time I will also let my family know.